Good afternoon. Today I will talk about the research that we have been doing in Cincinnati Children's Hospital regarding cerebellar Doppler velocimetry in fetal rats with open spina bifida as a novel marker to assess RNKi type 2 malformation. As we all know, studying animals in which we can induce neural tube defects is a really helpful method to assess two things. First, determining timing of in utero pathology, and second, possible therapeutic surgical approaches. In order to do this, we used high-frequency ultrasound, which ranges between 30 and 70 megahertz, that will allow us the non-invasive visualization of the small parts of the fetus, like the cerebellum within the uterus, with a spatial resolution of less than 100 micrometers, which was the objective of our study. The objective was to assess the fetal cerebellar oxygenation through the superior cerebellar artery at three different embryonic stages in an open spinal bifida animal, in this case, rat model. In the video of your left, you will see one of the types of open spina bifida, the mielomeningocele cell, and in the video of the middle, you will see the other type of open spina bifida that is called mieloschisis or also called mielocele. In the video of your right, you will see one of the types of spina bifida occulta, which is called meningocele cell. What is the main problem with the open spina bifida? The main problem with open spina bifida is that the fetuses that have this problem will develop RNKi type 2 malformation, which is the hindbrain herniation. So our study was an experimental controlled and blind study where pregnant rats were gavaged at day 10 of pregnancy. One group, our sham or control group with olive oil, and another group with retinoic acid. In this other group, we're gonna produce three different experimental groups. One where the fetuses developed open spina bifida, another group where the fetuses developed spina bifida occulta, and another group where the fetuses did not develop any neural tube defect. So we performed a high frequency ultrasound and Dopplers at day 15, day 17, and day 20, considering that the normal rat pregnancy duration is between 21 and 22 days. If we do the analogy with the human pregnancy, we could say that day 15 corresponds to 22 weeks of pregnancy, day 17 to 28 weeks, and day 20 with 36 weeks of pregnancy. In 1996, 20 years ago, Professor Giancarlo Mari performed a study to assess the oxygenation of the fetal cerebellum. In order to do this, he checked the pulsatility index of the superior cerebellar artery in normal human fetuses versus growth-restricted fetuses. And we used his approach in order to identify this artery. So first of all, we localize the circle of Willis, and instead of paying attention to the middle cerebral artery as we usually do, we're gonna pay attention to the posterior cerebral artery, another artery part of the circle of Willis. Once we are there, we keep on view this artery, and we're gonna tilt the transducer a little bit caudally to identify the superior cerebral artery, which arises from the basilar artery and runs parallel and posterior to this posterior cerebral artery. We need to remember that the cerebellum has its oxygenation through three main arteries: the superior cerebellar artery, which is identifiable by ultrasound, and two other inferior cerebellar arteries that are not easily identifiable by ultrasound. So which were the results? As I mentioned before, we checked the pulsatility index, the PI of the superior cerebellar artery at day 15, day 17, and day 20. And we realized that those fetuses that did not have open spina bifida, normal fetuses with a spina bifida occulta, or fetuses that did not develop neural tube defects in the group with retinoic acid, all of them, the pulsatility index of the superior cerebellar artery decreased along the pregnancy, which resembles the same pattern of the middle cerebral artery. And this happened because there is a spur of growth of the cerebellum at the end of the second trimester and at the beginning of the third trimester of pregnancy. In the case of those fetuses that develop open spina bifida and therefore hindbrain herniation, RNKi type 2 malformation, we didn't find this pattern. All the opposite, we realized that at day 17 and day 20, there was a significant difference, a statistically significant difference, between the PI in the superior cerebral artery. So the conclusions of our study are related to the facts that first, open spina bifida produces an increase in the pulsatility index of the superior cerebral artery. Second, that this increase may be due to a mechanical resistance to the blood flow in the posterior fossa as a consequence of the hindbrain herniation, which is the Arnold chiaritide malformation secondary to the open spina bifida. And third, that we are currently running the same study in human fetuses. As a preview, we can see here the picture of a normal human fetus at 20 weeks and 4 days. And here, you can see how we identify the circle of Willis. We identify both middle cerebral arteries. We identify this posterior cerebral artery. And also, we identify running posteriorly and caudally the superior cerebral artery. And in this picture, you can see how we perform the spectral Doppler of this artery, and we got the pulsatility index of this superior cerebral artery that at this stage is consistent with the measurements performed by Giancarlo Mari in 1996 when he assessed the pulsatility index of normal human fetuses, between 18 weeks and 40 weeks of pregnancy. Thank you very much.